Welcome, church, everybody. Hey, let's stand together. We're going to worship Jesus. But before we do, I just want to say a couple things. We got a friend with us this morning on my far right. His name is Jake France. And if you've been here for a while, you know that he was one of our worship leaders here at Harvest. And he's a worship pastor out in North Carolina right now. But he's a man of God, man of faith, and he's sowing into us this weekend. So can we thank God for Drake today? Amazing. Hey, we're going to read Psalm 136 before we jump into worship. I'm going to say the verse, and it ends with, "His love endures forever." So as I say that, we're going to respond and saying, "His love endures forever." You got it, church? All right, here we go. "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Give thanks to the God of gods. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, to him who alone does great wonders, who by his understanding made the heavens, who spread out the earth upon the waters. He remembered us in our low estate and freed us from our enemies. He gives food to every creature. Give thanks to God of heaven. His love endures forever." Come on, church, let's worship together.
It's the doorway into heaven. It's the pathway to his presence. We give thanks. It defeats all disappointment. Fills the house with holy moments, so we give thanks. Oh, we give thanks. We answer his good with hearts full of praise. We sing of his goodness, we sing of his grace. His love is forever, so now and forever. We welcome you here. my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I'm ready.
That's right.
I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I've tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you.
When we sing this, you call.
You call my name, and I ran.
Come on, lift your voice. The old man knew.
The old man knew. And Jesus, when I met you.
Thank you, Lord.
You called my name. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. You call me a citizen of heaven.
When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I had a future, my eyes are open. Cause when you come,
oh, come on, church, we shout it out together.
And I
together. Oh, come on, church, let's give him praise for bringing us out from death and into life. We worship you, Jesus. Amen. Hey, we're going to celebrate that we've been brought from death and into life through baptisms today, so why don't you turn your attention to the screen.
Good morning, Harvest family. My name's Larry. I get to serve as our pastor of Harvest Students. I'm here with Gabriel Calvario, who's getting baptized today. And this is his small group leader, David, who's been pouring into him and discipling him, and we're going to baptize this guy today. So, and a few more. It's going to be great. So, Gabe, can you tell me, when did you come to know Jesus as the Lord and Savior?
I come to know Jesus when I transferred to Harvest Students, and for the first year, I just came to know Jesus.
Praise God.
Yeah. Yes.
And you trust him for the forgiveness of your sins and spend an eternity with him. Praise God. And what has God been doing in your life since you came to know Jesus?
He has shaped my identity on who I am in Christ and to let me be able to understand him better through his word.
That's right. Come on, man. And, okay, so you're here in front of our whole church. Why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to publicly profess my death in my old self and resurrection in my new self and to walk with him in Christ.
Yes. Yeah. All right, dude.
Gabe, it's upon your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Let's go. All right, everybody, this is Brendan Hamm. Woo! Also part of David's small group, his small group leader right here, so it's awesome. Brendan, can you share with us a little bit of how you came to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yeah, I felt like up until last year, I didn't really have a relationship with Jesus. I knew about him, but I didn't have a relationship. So, like last year, I started actually like coming closer to him, and I really grew in my prayer life.
So. That's awesome. And so, dude, since then, what has God been doing in your life? Where have you seen him working in you?
Like I said, my prayer life, just like trusting in him and praying in all circumstances. And like my youth group leader says, just really being on fire for Jesus all the time.
That's awesome, man. It's awesome. And, okay, in front of your church family, why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to publicly profess my faith and trust in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Amen. All right, dude. Brennan, it's upon your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, we have another family member here. This is Delaney Hamm. All right, Delaney, can you share with us a little bit of how you came to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Well, I'm growing up in a Christian house, so I've always known Jesus as my Lord and Savior. It wasn't till September when he was saying to me, Delaney, you need to get baptized, and that just really spoke out to me.
Amazing. And so, how have you seen God working in your life since then?
Lately, I've been growing in my faith and listening to the sermons and not just sitting there. He's teaching me to be calmer and not take my anger out on people.
That's awesome. That's so great. All right, Delaney, in front of your whole church family here, why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to be baptized because I want to publicly profess my love for Jesus and be a true lover of Christ.
Amen. All right. Okay, you ready?
Mm-hmm.
All right, it's upon your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Everybody, this is Raven Coelho. Raven, welcome.
Thank you.
Now, can you share with us a little bit of how you came to know Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life?
I would give thanks to my aunt because when I was younger, I lived with my grandmother who was Muslim, and she really didn't accept me believing in Jesus. So she would be calling me a devil and like basically make fun of me for it. So when I told my aunt about that, she was like, just remember, Jesus is always there with you. And then just like remember to pray about like those things that you're going through and he will be there with you.
It's amazing. So through your relationship with your aunt, you came to know Jesus. That is so awesome. Praise God for that. And what has Jesus been doing in your life since then?
He, ever since I've been praying about, like, having siblings, he brought me to, like, my step-siblings, so they treated me like siblings, and I really just, I love them like my own siblings, and he also brought me to a good family that I always prayed for, too, since I really didn't have that much in my life, like a family.
So he's answering a lot of your prayers.
Mm-hmm.
Praise God. That's amazing. And so, Raven, in front of your whole church family, why do you want to get baptized today?
I just want to show God how much I love him and also give thanks to my aunt that for thanking her for making me believe in him.
That's awesome. And so we're going to baptize you today to proclaim you're going to follow Jesus forever, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, well, let's do it. All right, Raven. It's upon your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So great to get to have baptisms this morning and see what all God is doing. Would you stand with us in response and just gratitude for what God is worthy of?
All that I have is a hallelujah.
nothing else fit for, except for a heart singing hallelujah. So I throw on my hands and praise you again and again. It's all that I have.
Great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living
declare the grave has no claim.
'Cause you have broken every chain.
There's no one like our God. He is set apart. He is holy. There's no God above him. All the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but our God stands alone, and he reigns forever, and he's reigning now, and he will forevermore reign. So God, we ascribe everything that we've sung, all of this worth, all of this glory to you, because you're worthy of it. God, it is who you are. It is what you've done. God, you are the only one that can change a life, God. And we got to witness that this morning, the testimony of four lives, God, that you have changed and you've taken from darkness and sin and you've made them alive in Christ because of his sacrifice, because of his resurrection. And so we praise you, and we've praised you, and we'll continue to praise you for all of our days. And in the name of Jesus, all God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, hey, before we take a seat, why don't you just say hello to somebody that you didn't ride to church with this morning?
Well, good morning, everybody. Isn't it great to be here worshiping this King of Kings? It's awesome to think that we get time in our week, every week, to be here and to ascribe the worth to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. What a privilege. My name is John, and I serve as one of the pastors here. I oversee campuses and ministries, and what a privilege it is to worship alongside so many genuine, authentic believers who love Jesus. And maybe you've came here today for the first time. You're like, I'm going to go check out this church. Maybe someone invited you. Would you allow me and others on our team to get a chance to meet you after the service today? I'm going to be hanging out in the lobby in a place that says Harvest Connect. And would love to meet you and learn how you made your journey here today. And if there's something I can do to serve you, please let me know. And if you've been here at Harvest for a bit, you know that we have this app. It's on Church Center. And the reason why we ask you to check in every week is so that not just that we know that you're here, but we can connect throughout the week. You can submit a prayer request. You can check out what's going on in the church calendar through that app. You can learn so many things through that. But if you would just take a moment right now, if you don't have the app, you can scan the QR code on a chair near you and just let us know you're here today. That would mean a lot. And you know, these last couple weeks have been pretty difficult for our nation, right? In the southeast part of our country, there's been devastation, there's been ruin, and lives have been changed and homes have been moved and people are trying to figure it out. I think about Sherry and I when we came home one time from a trip, and there was just several inches of water, and the feeling that we had, and there's so many people that are, man, their life is being altered. And so as a people who are growing in our generosity, we get the chance to think about what can we do. And as a church, we get the opportunity to think about what can we do as a church. And so there's a couple of organizations that we're partnering with, and one of them is Send Relief, another one is Samaritan's Purse. They're on the ground. They are giving it up to serve this great Jesus that we love. And so we're gonna give $5,000 from the church, from the special offerings that come in at the beginning of the month, to just bless those who are going through some really challenging times. But think about what you can do. Think about how the Lord might just challenge your heart to give in response to that. And that's what he's asking us, to be a generous people. You know, we grow through the years in our walk with the Lord. And one of the classes we offer here is called My Design. And the goal of this class, I would love for each one of you to take it. Actually, it's one of our goals as a pastoral team that everyone in our church would take our core four classes. This is one of them. And it really helps us see our story and our gifts and our abilities and our passions. We watch them align and ask, Lord, how can you, being the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, use me where I am uniquely planted for your glory? And so on October 23rd at 6:30 to 8 for 4 weeks, I would really invite you to be a part of that class. It'll be something that really ministers to you in a great way. So you can go to the web to find out more information and register for that. Hey, how many of you are artists or creative? Anybody here? Not me, I can't raise my hand. But if you are, take a look at this.
Hi, I'm Wesley.
And I'm Riley.
We're looking for artists, writers, and makers. If you make any kind of art, we want to hear from you.
This is a great opportunity for you to use your gifts for the Lord. We have a really awesome project coming up soon, and we need you.
So scan the QR code or go to harvestbible.org. We'll be in touch. Fill out the form. We want to hear from you.
If you're that special artist, we have a special project, so be a part of that. We'd really appreciate that in a great way. You know, every week we pray for a local gospel church. Because of what's going on, we're going to pray for one outside of our area. We're going to pray for Kurt Gephardt, who's in the Tampa Bay area, Grove Bible Church. And he asked us to pray in this way. He said, hey, we're fine, but there's so many people in our area that have been devastated. And so would you pray that Pastor Kurt and his team can reach out into the community and minister with tangible expressions of love, but then also to be able to offer hope in the midst of devastation. So we're going to pray for him in a minute, but I want us to read 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 11 and 12 together. It says, you will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but also an overflowing in many ways of thanksgiving to God. You know, each week we take time in our service to give thanks to the Lord. We give a chance for our hearts to understand what thankfulness can be like welling up inside of us. And so there's ways that are listed on the screen for us to give our offerings for the Lord's work. But it's more than the Lord's work. It's what he wants to do inside of our hearts and well up this gratitude of thanksgiving. And so would you join me in prayer as we pray for Pastor Kurt. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Kurt and what you are doing in and through him and his church. There's so much devastation, there's so much ruin around that area, and people are probably wondering what their next step is. I pray that you'll give his team the ability to love and care and communicate your compelling love to meet them right where they are. So give him everything he needs. Give that church everything they need this day. And Father, I pray for those people that you would just help them to be able to approach you and understand you in a different way, and that they can look to you for hope. And I'm thankful for a chance we have right now to gather as a church, that we can, as the church, your people, open up your word and speak to us. And so I pray for Pastor Ramirez as he comes up and preaches God's word, that you would use him in a powerful way, that our hearts would be tender and ready to receive what it is from your word. And Lord, these offerings that we bring before you, whether it's today or on Tuesday or Wednesday or whenever we give, Lord, would you find our hearts just to be a growing generosity filled, thankful, grateful people. We love you and ask you to meet us right where we are today and minister to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We got to pray just to make it today. I said we pray. Oh yeah, we pray. We got to pray just to make it today.
Hey, good morning, Harvest. How's everyone doing today? My name is Romarez Moody. I serve as the campus pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And you're going to need a Bible this morning. And for our campuses that are joining us today, you're going to need a Bible as well. And I'm going to need for you to turn them to Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. As we continue in our series, Ask. This morning, we're going to have an opportunity to examine a prayer by Paul. And so Paul is the author of Ephesians, and this is the book that he wrote to the church in Ephesus, and he breaks the book down into two major parts. The first part being chapters 1 through 3, where we see the work of God, and then the second part being 4 and 5, where we see the walk of a Christian. And so today we're going to be at the end of the first part of the book, but the first three chapters are all about the church, the majesty of the church, the mystery of the church, which at the time was a mix of Jews and Gentiles who came together to create the body of Christ, the church. And the church is a term that we're all familiar with, right? Like we say, hey, we're going to church this morning. Or I hope the doors of the church are open today. Or, there's a church over there. But how many people in here know that the church is not a building? The church is a people. The church is who we are. For those who have put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, right? And it is where the presence of God indwells us as well. So the Ephesians, in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21, we'll find one of Paul's greatest prayers. That it's not for a person, it's for the church. It's for the church then, it's for the church now, and it's for the church in the future. I guess we can call this a prayer in perpetuity. It continues. It is applicable to the church now and forever. And his prayer for the church is that the church would experience God's mighty power through the Holy Spirit. And we know that Jesus told the disciples in Acts chapter 1 and 9 that they would receive power when the Holy Spirit came on them. And so Paul here is praying for that same power in the church. He's praying that the church will take full advantage of what we've been supplied in this thing called the Holy Spirit. So it's my hope today that we will learn how to pray for the church and the churches that sit around us each week. But whenever you come to the point of the text in the Bible about prayer, we should always make it a point to stop and take note because, let's face it, we all struggle with prayer, right? But there's some of us who have a gift of prayer. There's a few of them in this room right now. To where if this person is in the room and you need someone to pray, you're always calling on this person. Because this person's gift of prayer seems to provide encouragement to everyone in the room. It's almost like the ceiling is about to come down or Jesus is going to walk in the room, right? And they love doing it. But for most of us, it's a struggle, but it's beneficial. Paul knows this, and he petitions God on behalf of the church here in the text. So I hope that you've arrived at Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21, because we're going to read them together as we jump into God's word in the message that I'm entitling, A Church for the Body. A prayer for the body. A prayer for the body. All right, so let's see what Paul has for us in God's words this morning. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. You can also follow along on the screen if you don't have your Bible with you. It says, "For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant to you to be strengthened with the power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him who is able to do far more abundantly than we can, than all that we can ask or think, according to the power at work within him, in us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations forever. Amen." Okay, now we can go home, right? That is an amazing doxology, giving praise to the Lord there at the end. And so let's see what Paul has for us in this. But before we do that, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Will you join me in that? Lord, we thank you for an opportunity to learn about more about prayer. And so God, as we go through the text today, will you make my words clear to your people? I pray that the words spoken this morning will penetrate the hearts of your people. May we be changed and never the same after this. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so he starts here with a big "for this reason." And so as a Bible reader, whenever you see "for this reason," it's a rule of thumb to go to the previous chapter to find out what that reason is, which we will do in a minute. But Paul says, "For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named." For this reason. This is very interesting here, because "for this reason" in the text here doesn't really apply to the previous paragraph. The previous paragraph starts in chapter 1, verses 1 through 13. And here, Paul is starting again for this reason, but he's going off subject a little bit, because the subject matter is the church. And if you read the text, he's talking about God's divine plan for eternity. And so this comma here starts what is called a parenthetical pause. And a parenthetical pause is when an author takes a pause and kind of ventures off subject a little bit. And if you have some time later, you'll see, if you have time to read this later, you'll see that. But what we want to do is actually go back to chapter 2, where God is, or Paul is talking about the church and what God did for us as the church. Let's take a look at chapter 2, verse 5. It says, "Even when we, the church, were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together in Christ, by grace you have been saved." So through Christ we have been made alive, and through grace we are saved. Also here in verse 10, "For we are," the church, "are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Also, verse 19, "So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and the members of the household of God, And then verse 20, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone. Paul's going to refer to that also in the text. We're going to dig a little bit deeper on that. And then at the end of chapter 2, which is the last verse that will connect the "for this reason" in today's text, in him, you, the church, also being built up together into a dwelling place by God, for God, by the Spirit. And so Paul, in bowing his knee, is giving reverence to the Lord for what he has done with the church. And this bowing of the knee is a picture of humility. It is a picture also of a relationship. Notice he says, "I bow my knee to the Father." Of course, he could have said, "I bow my knee and exalt myself before the God of the universe." And God would be worthy of that praise, right? But Paul doesn't do that. He says, "I bow my knee before the Father." It speaks to an intimate relationship with our Heavenly Father. God does not want us to come to him in a way to appease him with flattery. No, he just wants us to come to him as a compassionate father. He's waiting to hear from us. He loves hearing from us. And I believe that he loves when we call him Father. He accepts us as his children, even when we are disobedient or ungrateful. Paul is bowing to his knees. And he's bowing, I believe, in awe of the fact that God created the church. And he gave the church an opportunity to be reconciled with him. And he's also given us this helper called the Holy Spirit. And bowing is written throughout the Bible, first in the Old Testament. In Psalms 95 and 6, it says, "Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord." And then Jesus in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 20, verse 26, it says, "And when he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them." Bowing is this gesture of honor before the Lord. I'm sure you've heard by now that a group of us went to Guatemala 2 weeks ago now. And while we were there, we prayed for the various churches that we visited. And I remember one church in particular, we're like, "Hey, we want to pray for you." They're like, "Great, yes." Everybody hit their knees. We're the only ones standing up like, "Oh, wait, okay, I guess we better." It's a picture of reverence for the Lord. It's the proper picture. And so here in the text, we see that Paul is petitioning the Lord on behalf of the church. And it is my hope today to pull out three of those petitions, each one being our point this morning. So the first petition in a prayer for the body is a prayer for the heart. And we see that in verses 16 and 17a. That according to the riches of his glory, he may grant to you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, according to the riches of his glory. Riches speaks to an abundance. It speaks to more than the average. If we look at it from this world's definition, it refers to the abundance of possessions exceeding the norm. But here we're talking about an abundance of God's divine nature. Paul's praying for that. And he's praying for his glory. All the time we say, "Lord, we want to bring glory to your name," right? But what exactly does it mean to bring glory to God's name? God is glorified when he's allowed to be seen for who he really is. God is glorified in his people when we live out his character in front of others. Paul is praying that the glory of his likeness and his divine nature dwells in our hearts. Heart here is not referring to an organ, of course, but it's always used figuratively in Scripture to refer to the seat at the center of human life. In other words, the things that control your intellect, the things that control your mannerisms, your attitude, your emotions, the inner person. And it's not a question of whether or not Jesus is in your heart. The question is whether or not he's comfortable there. We know Jesus Christ is in our hearts, but is he comfortable in staying put, dwelling and living and remaining? When we believe and accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, it happens. He comes there. But Paul is making a reference to Jesus being in our hearts without grieving him or without him feeling unwelcomed. So the question I have for us this morning is Jesus feeling at home in your heart right now? Paul's prayer for the church is that our hearts are pure, because let's face it, our hearts are wicked. And those are not the words of Pastor Ramirez. This is the word of the Lord. It's in Matthew chapter 15 and 19, and this is what he says about your heart and my heart. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, that's lying, and slander. Whew, that's some heavy stuff. I'm glad I didn't say it. But that's what the heart is. And so we want Jesus to feel comfortable in our hearts. This picture of the heart here in Matthew chapter 15, verse 19, is a heart that's far away from the Lord. What are the issues in our lives that could make Jesus feel unwelcomed in our hearts? Paul is encouraging us to take inventory on our lives and to pray and ask the Lord, if there's anything in my heart, oh Lord, please reveal it to me. Kind of like how David did in Psalms 139, verses 23 and 24. This is after David spends the whole chapter praising the Lord and admonishing his attributes. At the end, he says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts and see if there's be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting." Everlasting, that's eternal life. Paul understands the importance of that prayer in the fact that we could get tripped up in our hearts because our hearts house those grievous things. And Paul's just like, Lord, show me if there's any grievous thing in me. We can't follow our hearts unless Jesus is dwelling there. Praying that the Lordship of Jesus Christ will extend to every aspect of our life through the websites that we visit or through the way that we treat one another, the way that we spend our money, the way that we speak. Are we creating an environment that's welcoming to the Holy Spirit in our life is the question. And we fall short at this sometimes, myself included, which is the reason why we need God, right? Through the Holy Spirit, all the more. And that's why Paul is praying this here. And therefore, our prayer should be the same, that our life should reflect a constant seeking of these things. Paul is praying that our hearts will be aligned with God to where the Holy Spirit is welcome. And when it is revealed to us that it is not aligned, that we will repent and seek forgiveness for that, confessing it to the Lord. Confessing our sins to the Lord can be so life-giving sometimes. You know, sometimes we carry these heavy weights, man, and all we have to do is just say, Lord, will you take this burden from me? Will you heal my heart? I look back on my life and I wish that I was more quick to do that. When the Lord was convicting me of something wrong, when we can agree that, yeah, Lord, you showed me this thing, and oh yeah, I can agree, I need to get rid of that, that is a heart that's aligned with God. That is a heart that is a dwelling place of Jesus. You have created an environment to where Jesus Christ can be welcome there. It's not all about living the perfect life, right? But it is about responding to the conviction of the Holy Spirit when it reveals those areas in our lives. And sometimes this isn't an easy thing. That's why Paul is praying that we do this, that we be strengthened by the power of the Holy Spirit so that Christ can dwell in our hearts. Paul didn't say that I'm praying for you to be strengthened so that you can do it. No, he's praying that we be strengthened by the Holy Spirit. He said that I'm praying that you would have power through the Spirit to do this. It's got to be by the Spirit that we live this Christian life in this world around us with all of the distractions and all of the temptation. Our prayer life should be on our knees praying to be strengthened by the Holy Spirit. That's what the church should be doing. Even the power to recognize our sin and confess it to God comes from the Spirit. Thank God that Paul is conscious enough to know that this is the thing that we need. And I hope that we can embrace this. Which brings us to our next point. A prayer for the body is a prayer for stability. And we see that in verses 17b and 18, which says this, that you being rooted and grounded in love may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, that's the width, and the length, and the height, and the depth of that, of God's love. Rooted. We say here that that there are four marks of a disciple. We believe that one of them is uniquely planted. We believe that every disciple is uniquely planted. So if you're here, the Lord has you here. We believe that the mark of a disciple is carefully pruned. You go through life circumstances, the Lord convicts you, right? And then you turn from your sin. We believe that a mark of a disciple is persistently fruitful. But we also believe that a mark of a disciple is deeply rooted. And Paul speaks to the importance of that here in the text. Rooted is strengthened. Roots are important to keep a tree upright in a storm, in a hurricane. It is firmly established, consistent. Roots anchor us. My question for us today is, how deep do your roots go? Are we deeply rooted? It also says grounded, which is a construction term. Grounded speaks to the dirt beneath the foundation, underneath the foundation. Paul prays that we will have a firm foundation deeply rooted to comprehend the love of God. This is understanding the love of God, which is almost impossible. It is impossible. I shouldn't say almost. It is. You can build your house on the firm foundation of Jesus Christ, right? He is the cornerstone. He is our firm foundation. And Paul repeats this theme in Colossians chapter 2 and 6. He says, therefore, you have received Jesus Christ the Lord, so walk in him. And verse 7 says, grounded, rooted in a firm foundation. Paul is praying that the church is consistent in Christ, understanding God's love for us, built on the cornerstone of Jesus Christ. Jesus makes a reference to the importance of that as well in the Sermon on the Mount here in Matthew chapter 24 through 25. It says, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew, but my house was built on you, right? We sing that all the time. And beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. There's an old school song that my church used to sing. I go to the rock. Anybody remember that? I go to the rock. The rock of Jesus Christ. That is my firm foundation. The remix to that is here at Harvest, the firm foundation. We sing it all the time, right? The storm came, the winds blew, but my house was built on you. Paul prayed that we as a church would be deeply rooted in a relationship with Christ because it would be the thing to sustain us in the storms of life. And there's going to be some storms. Thinking that with all the things that are happening around us, we need a firm foundation. Because if it is not founded on the love of Christ, in the midst of a storm, you could think that God doesn't love you. And you could start to question whether or not he does, which is a dangerous place to be. But we know that he does. His love, this agape love, it is an unconditional love. It's a natural love for him, but it's the love that we ought to be deeply rooted in and understand and comprehend. Several hundred miles off of the coast of Guam is the Mariana Trench. It's the deepest place in the ocean. On January 23rd, 1960, Jacques Pichard and Donald Walsh climbed into a submersible vessel and were lowered into the cold, lonely darkness. Their descent into the deep, which set a world record that has not since been repeated. Even in today's modern technology, it has not been repeated. The depth of the ocean is mind-boggling, but so much more in the Mariana Trench because they actually went there. They measured it. There's depths of the ocean that we haven't even gotten to yet. The Mariana Trench is nearly 7 miles down. I was thinking about this the other day because my trip from my house to church is 7 miles, but at about 35 miles an hour, actually 42 miles an hour. And I'm like, man, this is a long way to drive at 48 miles an hour. But the water pressure at that depth is 15,900 pounds per inch. Yet there's life. In fact, Walsh testifies that he saw a flat fish on the ocean floor surviving despite of the pressure and the darkness. For most of us, it's hard to fathom just how deep the Mariana Trench is, but much more difficult to comprehend the depths of God's love. Paul was hard-pressed to describe it, but he prayed that we would be able to somehow grasp it, the width and the depth and the height, to know the love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge. The reason that we can never reach the depth of God's love is because it's infinite. It's immeasurable. We will never reach it. But there are depths of God that many Christians have not even begun to explore. However, they are accessible. They are accessible. Paul knows this. He knows the love of Christ. He's experienced it, right, on the road to Damascus. And he wants the church to experience it as well. He wanted the church in Ephesus to understand how well God loved them and how to understand the depth of it, rooted in the love of Christ. Which brings us now to the final point. A prayer for the body is a prayer to know. And we see that in verse 19. And to know the love of Christ that surpasses all surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. And to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. That's an interesting statement there, that first part. He's basically saying, I want you to know that which surpasses knowing. I want you to know that which surpasses knowing. Where do you even start with that, right? What exactly does that mean? The know that he's talking about here is experiential knowledge. The experiential knowledge that surpasses knowledge. To experience and to know the love of Christ that goes beyond the factual realm to an experiential realm. We can load our heads up with knowledge all day long, right? But never have an experience with God's love. Look at the author who's writing this. He has some experience, right? He was the king of Christian killers. He hated Christians. Until that day, on his road, on his way to Damascus to kill more Christians, he had an experience. And his life was radically changed. Which is usually what happens when you have an experience with God's love. You are radically changed. You get knocked down and you get back up again. Like, that was no problem. Paul was the same way. Like, how many times did he go to jail, right? Like, went to jail, gets let out, and he's back doing the same thing that he went to jail for. Like, if I got locked up in Cook County Jail for preaching the gospel on the street, I don't know. And they let me out, I don't know. But Paul didn't care. He was a radical Christian because he had a radical experience with the Lord. If you're sitting here today and you're thinking, maybe I haven't had an experiential radical experience with God's love, it doesn't mean that God doesn't love you. Maybe you should just ask. Maybe the prayer is like, God, I want to have an encounter with you. I want to experience your love. And just keep praying. until it happens. Lord, will you fill me in the fullness of God? And just keep praying it until it happens. Because it's going to happen. And these are not the words of me yet again, but it is God's words. And we see that here in 1 John chapter 5, verse 14. It says, and this is the confidence that we, the church, have towards him, God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. We should have confidence in that. We have confidence, Paul says, that we can ask something to God, and if it's in his will, it will be done. Do you think he wants you to have an experiential knowledge of his love? I would think so. As a church, we have to enter the throne room with that expectation and confidence that whatever we ask for in God's will, it will be done. Paul petitions God on behalf of the church. I love Paul in his heart. He's just like, oh man, let me help y'all out a little bit. I'm gonna pray on your behalf. Lord, will you do this in your church? And then he ends with this doxology. And look, if you guys don't leave here with anything, I want you to leave here with this. I first want to read this over us. Verses 20 and 21. Now unto him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we can ask or think according to the power at work within us. To him be the glory in the church, and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and forever. And the church said, amen. Amen. If you don't leave here with anything other than this, remember this, God is able. God is able. When you go home today, I want you to Google or go to YouTube and just type in all of the worship songs with that. God is able. And just play it to yourself on the way to work, while you're cutting the grass. Remind yourself that God is able, but also remind yourself that God is able to do. God is able to do, but don't stop there. God is able to do what we ask. God is able to do what we ask, but don't stop there. God is able to do what we think. God is able to do all that we ask or think. He's able to do more abundantly than all that we can ask or think. He's able to do far more abundantly than all that we could ask or think. According to what? According to the power that is within us. He's able. And as we align our hearts with him and allow him to dwell there, when we pray, our prayers would align with his will. And our prayers get answered. Wow. All the time. Because we're praying according to his will, because our hearts are aligning with him. You see how that works? Sometimes we're going before the Lord in prayer and our hearts are out of order. Paul is saying, pray that our hearts be strengthened, and pray that our hearts are a dwelling place for Christ Jesus. And pray for an experiential moment with him and his love for us. I want to encourage you to pray in faith, asking God to do far more all that we can ask or think. Be bold in that. Because if it's in God's will, he's going to do it. I can testify to that. I had a praying mom. Who didn't judge me, just prayed for me. Even when I was lost, she was on her knees praying for me. And this is the end result. Keep in mind, in the context of Paul's prayer for God to do abundantly beyond what we can ask or think. And this is not a prayer for physical miracles, but for Christ to dwell in our hearts so that we may comprehend his great love for us, so that we may grow in complete spiritual maturity. That's what this is all about. God said that he would send us a helper. A helper to do what? Not to store up the largest retirement account that we can get, or to help us clean the house. No, to help us become mature Christians. When you can believe and begin to get this idea in your heart, it will change the way that you pray. When you can begin to utilize the tools that we have access through the power of the Holy Spirit, that is at work within us, it will change your life and it will change your walk with the Lord. I think a part of the reason that many of us don't take advantage of this is because we're just too comfortable. We have a lot of comforts. You know, many of us, all of us live in mansions compared to the families in Guatemala. I think about being in this church in Guatemala and everyone having the joy of the Lord. You would think that these people lived in mansions. But no, I can tell you, I went to their house and their ceiling height was barely my height. And their floors were dirt floors. And their walls were cardboard. The roof's metal. But they had the joy of the Lord. And they dropped to their knees when it was time to pray. They had a real, true reverence for the Lord. I share with the lady who welcomed us into her home. It's a part of their culture to show honor to people coming into their home. It was I, a pastor, and another pastor. So she wanted to show honor to the pastors. And so in their tradition, they collect pine needles and they spread them across the floors of their homes. And there's not a pine tree in sight. There's not a Walmart to go and buy pine needles. So there was some effort to show honor. I had never felt more welcomed in someone's home before in my life. They lived out the character of Jesus Christ in their lives, giving reverence to the Lord, praying for strength in their spirit, I believe, because they have strong faith. But when God sometimes is trying to shake us up, to make us uncomfortable, it is so that we can be strengthened in the Spirit, and so that we can come to him and ask for help in our time of need. Let us be a church to do that. Let us be a church that is constantly calling on the Lord for strength, calling on the Lord and asking him for help in the areas that we are falling short in the areas that we are weak in, and watch what he does, because he's able. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for who you are in our lives. And we thank you for your love, this agape love, this love that loves us so much that you do not want to keep us the same. You want to grow us, Lord. So, Lord, teach us, show us, remind us to pray for strength in the Holy Spirit so that we may be a dwelling place for you. We thank you and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, church. Let's stand and respond. Sing it out with me.
To him who is glory, who is able to do more than we could ask or imagine. Amen, amen. Now to him be the glory. Let his people shout his victory through all generations. Amen, 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 amen.
I have been saved by the grace of God, amen. I have been without end, I said mine. On a true and loyal friend, whose life I'm hidden in.
Yeah.
Amen. You can clap. Let's go. What a great day to be together, and it doesn't have to end. You can hang out in the lobby and get to know one another and care for one another. If you came here today and you're like, man, that message about prayer, we've been in this series, Ask, Seek, and Knock, and this week was a challenging one for you, I would encourage you, come on down front. There's people who would love to pray with you, come alongside you and care for you. And know that as we all go out this week, we get to go to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords anytime during the week and just ask for wisdom, knowledge, and discernment. And He promises to give it to us. And so with that truth, and we go out on mission, know this, that you are loved. Have a great week.